Before jumping to gRPC, let's talk about REST APIs. So to give some context, we had some legacy apps, which are monoliths, something in Rails, something in PHP. We wanted to move into a more front-end and back-end separated way. So we started building services for our use, and we are separating the front-end. So we started with REST APIs only. So there are good things about REST APIs, like well-defined HTTP verbs, like, and JSON objects can be easily consumed by any JS libraries, and it's curl-friendly, like you can access by any HTTP clients, and almost all the languages have matured HTTP libraries as well, right? So you don't have to deal with any underlying things. But when we are using that for microservices, we face some of the problems, like not everything is a resource, right? Because consider an example of calculator service. Maybe the rates, which can be properly represented in a REST way. But consider an endpoint like calculate premium. So these are like functionalities. These are not necessarily a resource. So it would become a JSON APIs from REST APIs. And the problem with using multiple languages is like whenever you write some services in one language and you want to consume in another language, you have to create all these stub codes. Like for example, you have a user service which provides user information, let's say get user and create user. So when you want to consume in Ruby, you have to create classes like for request and response, and you would create some service clients which would make abstract the HTTP calls for you. Similarly, when you write in Go, yeah, sorry for the resolution. So so this is a Go code, like the same set of code you have to write in all the languages you are going to consume for the internal services. And there are other problems, like for internal services also, you have to maintain your API documentation. And if something is rapidly changing, like you have to keep up with those libraries, which we have created in different languages whenever the service is changing. And you have to update the API documentation as well. And JSON is text-based, right? So which adds unnecessary performance burden when serialization and deserialization. Maybe for a couple of services, it may not you may not feel the performance burden. But considering a workflow involves multiple microservices, and each time for a workflow to work, it will make sequence of calls, and each time you are marshalling and unmarshalling into JSON, you will feel that performance. So gRPC. So gRPC is like similar to any other RPC systems existing before, but with some better features. Like I used to work in Java, so I used EJBs before. So gRPC is simple, like you have a gRPC server and you have a couple of clients. So each client will have its gRPC stub to interact with the gRPC server. So from your clients, you will just call methods in the stub, which internally it will make a request to the gRPC server and receive the response and give the output of that method back to you. So you will feel like it's like a local method call instead of an HTTP calls or anything. Everything is hidden. And here, gRPC, some of the features, like it is a high performance RPC system developed by Google, and it uses HTTP2 for the transport, and it uses protocol buffer as the message format. So typical our REST APIs would use JSON for request and response, right? It uses protocol buffer, which is a binary message system, and it supports different communication modes, unary, client-side streaming, server-side streaming, or bidirectional streaming, and you can add the middleware layers, like we have discussed, like it's difficult to add the authentication layer into the GraphQLs, right? So that's an inbuilt functionality to add authentication system on top of gRPC. And if you want to add additional middleware layers like logging or anything else you want to, you can do that as well. So protocol buffer. So it's a mechanism for serializing structured data, similar to JSON or XML. It's another way of representing the structured data. So as I said, it follows the binary message format, and it's used to describe both service interfaces as well as the message format. If you use the SOAP before, like we have the similar thing called WSDL, right? So previously we used to describe the services and the request and response messages, everything in the WSDL file. So similarly, we'll have a proto file. It's a simple one, like it's simpler than the WSDL. So here I defined a service user data, which have a couple of endpoints, create user, which accepts the create user request and returns the user. And similarly for the get user, it accepts the get user request and returns the user. So what are the parameters in my create user request? Everything is defined in here. So it has a first name, last name, email, everything is string. Similarly for the get user request, I can either pass ID or email. And the response user, it contains the ID, which is integer, and string, first name, last name, and email. This is a simpler one. So all my service related details, everything is in a single file. Use of protocol buffer has some advantages, like better performance by using the binary format rather than the text-based encoding. And it's easy to read and understand the service and message definition. So it's better than WSDL, and it's in some ways, it's better than the API documentation itself, right? So whatever your service accepts or what are the inputs and outputs, everything is defined in a single place. And this is the one to use to generate the service as well as the stubs. One of the good things with protocol buffer is like you can automatically generate the stub classes programmatically. Like currently, I think some 10 plus languages being supported. So you don't have to worry about this stub generation in the client side for each of your language. So benefits of gRPC. So as I mentioned earlier, protocol files, it acts as a service documentation itself. Like to any developer, like reading the protocol file, it's better than going through the documentation. An automatic code generation for stubs using the protocol compiler. So each language has its compiler to read this protocol file and generate the stubs for according to that language. For example, if I run the Ruby compiler, it will generate the classes for me. If I run the Go compiler, it will create the struts for me. And it provides the better performance by using two things, like HTTP2 for the transport and protocol buffer, the binary format for the serialization. Writing gRPC service. So writing gRPC service, it's a simple like four-step. First, you will start with the service definition in a protocol file format, and you will generate the client and server code in the protocol compiler using protocol compilers. Then you, it will generate some base classes for you. So you can extend the base classes and implement the server. And to use it in the client side, using those stubs generated, you can call the methods in the stub. You can communicate, configure the URL for that gRPC server, and that you are good. You are good to use that. So let's see a demo. Is it clear now? Okay. So we'll start with the protocol file. So as I mentioned earlier, the same protocol file I use here. I'm following the protocol file version 3, and I defined the package. I mentioned the version for this service. And we have a service user data, and which has two endpoints, create user, get user. The same request and response messages we defined. When I run the compiler, it generates these two files for me. Like, this is the stub, I can use it in my client, and it created the service for me. And for the request and response, it created the model classes for me. So I use the package, a gem called graph. So this is an existing Rails API, we added gRPC on top of that. So I extended that base graph controllers and bind with that service which has been generated by using this protocol file. So I defined these two methods, create user and get user. So which basically create an active record whenever a new user is created. And if there is any error, it will throw an error messages. Get user is simple, like if it has an email, it will use the find by email. And if it receives the ID, it will do the find and return the response. Simple thing, similar to our application controller. This is a sample Ruby client. So using the same proto file, I generated the stubs for my Ruby application, Ruby client. In the client, all I have to do is record gRPC, record that generated PB files, connect to the gRPC server, construct the request, and call the methods in the stub. So all I have to do is writing this file only. So I don't have to write all other files. It will be automatically generated. The same with Golang as well. The same protofile used to generate this big one. But in the client, so now with gRPC generated that code for me, all I have to write is the same thing. I set up a connection to the gRPC server. I construct the request and call the method in the stub. So without gRPC, I have to implement the same stubs code in Ruby as well as in Golang. But gRPC saves us time for me. So we start with the gRPC server. So I have two clients here. One is in Ruby, another one is in Golang. So one is to hit the create user endpoint, and two is to, is it visible? So two is to hit the get user endpoint. So the first time, if you see, it returns the response properly because it created the record over there. The second time, I throw that error directly back to here. You can see that email has been already taken. So error, and I can throw the errors created in the Rails service directly back to here. Similarly, to consume the same service in Golang. So I query for this email ID, and it returns, it receives that user object back to it. Now I'm able to receive it. So similarly, if I want to add a new endpoint to that protofile, all I have to do is add another RPC endpoint here, and then I have to regenerate that protofiles in each of the clients. Only if I need it. Like, let's say in my Go client, I want to use the new endpoint, but in my Ruby client, I don't want to use that. I'm not in need for that newly created endpoint. So I can still use the existing one. But in my Go client, I can generate the stubs with the updated proto or the next version of this proto file and still communicate with this. Unless I don't change the existing message formats, I can still use with that older proto file versions. Do we have time for live code? Ah, okay. So let's try adding one more service. Yeah. So we are going to create a new endpoint, delete user, so which accepts delete user request and returns the delete response. So I'm going to define these two messages first. So delete user request contains ID alone, and the delete response contains the Boolean flag, whether it's been deleted or not. Okay. So what do we have to do now? So for the service side, I'm going to generate the stubs and service files again. So in that service file, the new endpoint is added. In the controller, I'm adding that one again. So for the response object, it also already created. So now my server side code is done. So I'm trying to destroy that record based on the ID from the incoming request. And if it's deleted, I'm sending the status true. Otherwise, I'm sending the status false. I'm restarting my server. I'm going to generate the with the new protofile changes in the Ruby client alone. So first I'm copying that protofile. And I'm generating the stubs again for the Ruby client. So the new change, new endpoint I added is added in my client side also. Now I can go to my client and directly call this methods in this type. So I have to construct the request first. So I construct the delete request. I'm going to call that. delete user method. Let's try this. So this has to be converted into a number. Well. Because I think I named it wrong. Right? Okay, so it throws the error, couldn't find the user account with ID 10. So let's try with some other ID. It's deleter and the response. Yeah. So for the normal web client, there are you can use, but there are still proxies being involved to convert into the JSON or other easily consumable. So it's more suitable for your internal services as well as your mobile clients because it supports for Objective-C and Android Java version as well. So you can use for the internal services and your mobile clients. Web clients, I would still go with JSON services. Yep. It's still there are not many mature libraries in Ruby, so even when I tried, I found only graph. But if you will go with HTTP or if you want to write JSON library endpoints, there are a bunch of libraries available in all the languages, right? It's still evolving, and one of the good thing, okay, bad things are still we are exploring, like they're selling this performance and other things, right? We have this REST endpoints and we are slowly adding this gRPC as well. During the usage in life, we will get to know what are the disadvantages of that. Yep. So there are different ways we are thinking. The first one is like adding the version number in the package itself, or keep the different proto files for different versions itself if it's a drastic change. For the minor version, we are planning to add this version 1.1, 1.2 in the package level itself. So in a same client, I can use the different versions of that gRPC services. Yep. So for your internal services, developer is your consumer, right? So I would rather read this service definition file and the message format rather than going through the documentation to understand. Maybe for the purpose of this services and usage, you may still need that API documentation for sure. But what is my input, what is my output, and what are the methods I'm exposing? I would rather go with this definition file rather than the API documentation. But yep. Sorry? Yes. No, but consider the number of lines it's generated in the stub classes, right? So once I write the service definition file, I can directly write my service and client. It created the base classes or base struts needed for me. Sorry?
Is it rough? It has a built-in server.
Yep.
It takes bypasses the whole. It's not HTTP.
Yep.
So it's not actually running Rails proper.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that the server is production ready?
So for the gRPC server itself, it's production ready. It's already used. But the graph thing, it's for the Rails, if you want to add on top of another Rails API, which you are using the REST, so the graph is easy to add. So that's why we are using the graph. But still, is it production ready? That's debatable. Like, I don't think that graph is still production ready.
Right. I mean, that is the
only thing. Yeah. You can manually run your server with a gRPC implement, but you have to write some basic code at the moment in Ruby. Yeah.
As a practical matter, where do you store the protocol?
You
have it in your own repo?
Yep.
I just want to add that it is extremely nerve-wracking for someone to stand in front of everybody to a live demo to show a new feature.
Yeah.
So please help me to give it a try.
Thank you.